from 1 Timothy, chapter 6, verses 6 through 11, and then skipping down to verses 17 through 19. It says, actually, godliness is a great source of profit when it is combined with being happy with what you already have. We didn't bring anything into this world, so we can't take anything out of it. We'll be happy with food and clothing. But people who are trying to get rich fall into temptation. They are trapped by many stupid and harmful passions that plunge people into ruin and destruction. The love of money is the root of all kinds of evil. Some have wandered away from the faith and impaled themselves with a lot of pain because they made money their goal. But as for you, run away from these things and instead pursue righteousness, holy living, faithfulness, love, endurance, and gentleness. Tell people who are rich at this time not to become egotistical and not to place their hope on their finances, which are uncertain. Instead, they need to hope in God who richly provides everything for our enjoyment. Tell them to do good, to be rich in the good things they do, to be generous and to share with others. When they do these things, they will save a treasure for themselves that is a good foundation for the future. That way they can take hold of what is truly life. Please pray with me. Lord God, we thank you for this, your word. Your word that challenges us, your word that calls us to action. May this time today, Lord, be filled with your presence and your words and your message that you want each of us to hear. It's in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. So I want to get right out and I want to tell you all something you need to know. You're weird. You are weird, and I am weird. We are all weird, or at least we're supposed to be. I rarely use a title in the bulletin that means much to the sermon, but this week in our time together, I wrote down this title, and it's kind of essential to what we're going to talk about, and the title is Christians Have Weird Wallets, which if nothing else, if you did look at the bulletin today, had to make you at least wonder what was wrong with Alec after his week off, you know? Christians have weird wallets, and if we don't, we're called to. You and I are called to have weird wallets for things to look different because we're Christian. We're weird because we're part of this Jesus tribe that makes us make different decisions, and that includes about our money. And before we go too far into this, you need to know that this isn't just my own idea, and I'm not just calling you weird just for fun, but that it comes from a book called Weird, and it says, because normal isn't working. Amen. You agree with that, Carl? Because normal isn't working, we're called to be weird. This is written by a megachurch pastor called Craig Groeschel that I've been listening to since 2013. And so today we talk about what it means to be weird, especially what does it mean to have a weird wallet? I was reminded this week of the movie Charlie and the Chocolate Factory. I know it's been made and remade, but I'm going to look at a line that comes from the 2005 remake with Johnny Depp. And I think it can help us understand and get an idea of why and what we're called to be weird about. In the movie, 5 golden tickets are up for grabs. And that shows they're really extremely rare. Charlie gets one of these tickets, but he wants to sell it. He wants to get the money for it because his family needs it, because his grandpa needs the money. And then his grandpa says these great words. He says, there's plenty of money out there. They print more every day. But this ticket, there's only 5 of them in the whole world, and that's all there's ever going to be. Only a dummy would give it up for something as common as money. Chad, can you turn me down just a little bit? Thank you. Here's what I think we can learn from this. Charlie's grandpa is weird, right? He's weird. He has this opportunity to get some money that he much needed, and he explains that there's something bigger than that sometimes. Normal people would jump on the opportunity to get the money that they need. Normal people would, but weird people see that there's something more than money out there. There's something more important than money. There are things that are more unique and more precious than money. Here's the deal, church. We may not have a golden ticket, but we need to remember that great wisdom, that there are things that are more precious than money. There are things that are more unique than money. You sitting here right now, you're more important. You mean more than any dollar amount, and God has made only one you. How about our lives? Our lives, we were given one life to live. Isn't that a soap opera? One life to live? Okay. We're given one life to live. That's more precious than any money. And only a dummy would give it up for something as common as money. Our scripture today from 1 Timothy has been used by pastors all over to talk about money. So maybe many of you have heard this before, but there's two things I want to draw out of this in our time together today. The first one's what Paul writes in verse 6. He says, "Godliness is a great source of profit when it is combined with being happy with what you already have." I don't know about you, but being happy with what I already have is something I struggle with sometimes. I think it's something we always don't do very well. But Paul says that when we start to see the blessings that God has already placed in our lives, when we start finding contentment, we'll start having a godly attitude. We'll quit worrying about money, and we'll start to see happiness. I think one of the issues and one of the reasons we don't find contentment very easily is that we're too accustomed to looking at comparisons. We're too good at looking at someone else and thinking that since they have something or they have so much money that we're not good enough anymore. We get caught in a cycle of always wanting more and more because we compare ourselves to others around us. Here's what I know. It's normal, hear me, it's normal to compare ourselves to others. But we want to be weird, right? It's easy to look at someone else and their family and look at their job and their home and their car and their TV and say, I want that. Or worse off, we see all these things, these normal signs of wealth, and we think since we don't have the best or we don't have what they have, we're not successful or we're not good enough. We see someone's wealth and we think that because of this comparison, we're poor. Normal is to do that. But we're called to be weird. We have to stop these comparisons. We have to stop judging our value by comparing it to someone else. And as a side note, this goes for more than just money, you know. We have to quit thinking we're ugly because we don't look like someone on a runway or in a magazine. We have to quit thinking that we're not smart because the person on Jeopardy answered more questions than we do. You know, I've been in that boat. I love Jeopardy. We have to stop thinking we're not good enough and we're not talented enough and we're not skilled enough because someone can do something that we cannot. We have to stop comparing ourselves to others because what I do know is that God isn't comparing you. Jesus didn't come so that you could live your life in stress and constantly compare yourselves to others. Instead, Jesus came to give you life and life abundant, a life to live, a full life of happiness. When we live by thinking we're not smart, we're not beautiful, we're not successful, I don't think we're always living the life that Jesus came to give us. And this is just the thing. With money, when we compare ourselves to others, when we see others' successes as our downfalls, we stress. We stress instead of finding contentment in what God has already given us. But if you want to look at comparisons for just one second, there's always going to be someone richer and there's always going to be someone that needs more help than we do. There are times in life where we'll be up and down that scale, but there's always going to be someone better off financially and there's always going to be someone more down on their luck financially than you. So we have to stop the comparisons. We need to be content with what we have instead of always trying to keep up with the Joneses. I don't know where that saying came from, but I like it. Now, I want to be open and honest and a bit vulnerable with you all right now, and you may laugh at me when you first hear this, but I think there is a real reason that God put this topic in front of me today, And I think there's a reason that God has brought me to speak to you on this today, because I struggle with finding contentment. I struggle with being content with what I already have, because I think, like many of us, we always want something more. And for me, I struggle with being content, especially in the field of technology. I'm one of those guys that always wants the newest, the hippest, which by saying hip, you're not hip, I found out. I'm always wanting the newest, the greatest thing. For example, I always want the newest Apple device to make sure I'm on the cutting edge, that I have the newest and nicest technology. And then I tell myself lies that I need it. I need that because it'll help my productivity. I need it because it has more capabilities than what I already have. But in reality, I think sometimes I'm not being content with what I already have. So I told you this past week I had a chance to take a weekend off, and I went up to Madison to watch Stacy run a half marathon. And after that, we went to the mall in Madison. And the mall in Madison has an Apple store, which is just a trouble for me already. And this nice salesperson who wanted to be my friend or just wanted to upsell me, either one would have worked, showed me the Apple watches, and I fell in love. I'm like, whoa, I can do all this on my wrist? It was like James Bond, you can talk into it, you know? I fell in love with this little object. I kept telling myself, well, you know, if I do get it, I could keep my calendar better organized and it'd be right at my wrist. I kept telling myself, well, I'll respond to emails and texts even quicker than I already do. But thanks to Stacy's level-headedness, she pulled me away from this shiny display and we went home, to which I went on apple.com and I continued to look at the different options of how I could make sense of getting an Apple Watch. You know, I was stressing over it, how I could make this dream happen. Then I started preparing for this sermon. Message received, you know. I don't need the Apple Watch. Now, I could come up with excuses for getting it, and in reality, I wasn't content with what I already have. Now, if you do have an Apple Watch, I'm not trying to criticize you. In fact, I'd love to talk to you. I want to hear a little more about it. But we're all in different places. So, but I spent time with this. I spent time with this and searched my heart and realized that God was telling me, Alec, are you being content with what you already have been blessed with? So my question is, where are you at with this today? I mean, I'm not saying everybody wants to go out and buy Apple Watches, but we all have desires. We all have things that we crave. We all have things that we envy of other people. Having a desire to have nice things isn't bad, but when we're stressing over it, when we're coveting other people's lifestyles, it's a sign that we're not content with the blessings God has already given us. And when it takes time, when we start talking about giving to the church, if we're not content with what we have, if we're not noticing the blessings we already have, if we're stressing, trying to keep up an appearance or keep up with a trend, we're not going to give. We're more likely not to give. And here's the thing, God has called you and has called me to support the work of Jesus in this world, and that includes financially through our money. But if we don't see that we've been blessed, if we're always searching to keep more money for ourselves, it's going to be hard to give. We can't just give when we're happy. We can't just give when we're on that upswing. It's about giving at all times. It's about knowing that the money we have in our life isn't ours. 1 Timothy said it beautifully. We don't bring anything into this world and we can't take anything with us. The money isn't ours. It's God's that we've been blessed with. So that's why finding contentment is so essential. It's normal in our society to see what someone else has and desire to have it. It's normal to see a family and their success and to think that we're unsuccessful because we don't measure up to them. That's normal. But remember, Christians have weird wallets. Christians are called to be content with what God has blessed them with, to find contentment in their situation. That's weird, right? It's weird to be content with your financial situation. To go back to our reading from 1 Timothy, I said there was two things I wanted to highlight. First one was finding contentment. The other one gets misinterpreted too much. It says the line, "The love of money is the root of all kinds of evil." Will you read that with me? The love of money is the root of all kinds of evil. Money itself is not evil. Money has the ability to do great things. Money helps us do ministry here at Grandview. Money helps us do mission. Money, including Domka, helps us do mission in Domka. But if we read this verse, it's the love of money that has the potential for evil. And I think this verse can be tricky, and I know it makes people uncomfortable, but what I think God is trying to tell us through Paul is that we need to check our priorities. If we love money, if that replaces our love that we have for God, or the love we have for others, then we need to check our priorities. Money can't be our goal. It can help us get to goals, but it can't be our goal. Our goal should be a life with Jesus. I tread lightly on this topic because it's a fine line to determine between love of money and having a strong work ethic. But I believe, again, God's trying to say, check your priorities. I was glancing through Facebook a while back, an acquaintance of mine from Tipton posted something on his wall. He wrote, "If you're celebrating that it's the weekend, then you're celebrating that you're not out making money. Get out and get to work." I'm like, okay, well, it's one thing to have a really strong work ethic. But then I kept reading, and he said, "Being dedicated and loving wealth is nothing to be ashamed of." Now, I'm not here to condemn him. I don't know him that well. I'm just here to say that could be, in an everyday example, what the love of money looks like. That we've placed a love of wealth above everything else that we do. And again, we're called to check our priorities. Now, I don't know if you know this. Last week, we had our church/charge conference where we did just this as Grandview. We checked our priorities. And we came up with our 5 priorities for the next year, and I want to share those with you. Those include growing mission opportunities, expanding our outreach ministries, continuing worship, small groups, and service, building an effective Christian education system, and growing our financial health. Those are in no specific order, but they really excited me. They made me excited to be part of Grandview because 4 out of 5 of those are all about the mission and ministry of God to work through Grandview. And the 5th one is how we're able to make it happen. Notice that the goal of Grandview is not to have the most money of all churches in Dubuque. The goal of Grandview is not to take every dollar that you have and put it in our pockets. The goal of Grandview is to do God's work in the world, and giving allows us to do that. That's why I love being a part of this church. We've checked our priorities. My question for you today is, are your priorities the same? This is where the rubber hits the road, that we have to check ourselves on these 2 things. First, are we content with what we have, or are we always stressing, trying to keep up with the richest, most successful people around? I'll tell you this, it's normal to not be happy with our financial situation. It's normal to always want more. It's normal to envy and covet others. But Christians have weird wallets. And we're called to be content and recognize that God has blessed us more than we'll ever know. The second thing we're called to check is to check our priorities. Is our number one priority and our number one love money? Because if it is, then we possibly need to check our priorities again and get them aligned correctly, that God is number one. I said it earlier, Jesus Christ was born and died on the cross for you, so that you may have life. And I don't think he died for a life where we're craving and always seeking money. I do think we're called to work hard, and I think we are called to be responsible stewards of our money, but I don't think we should love it. Normal people love money. Normal people have number one priority being money, but Christians have weird wallets. We have a bigger priority. And that's a relationship with Jesus, who has blessed us and will continue to bless us. So when we talk about giving and we talk about a tithe, which is 10% of your paycheck or of your salary that goes to God, if we're stressed about money or if we're craving more money, we're probably not going to do it. But if we're content with what God has blessed us with, and if we have Jesus as our number one priority, which is weird, I know, then we're probably going to start giving to God. I want to end with where we started, and that's the story of Charlie and the Chocolate Factory. And I was reminded at 8 o'clock, I just ruin movies for you guys all the time, but I'm going to go ahead and skip to the end of it. And Charlie wins the grand prize at the end of the tour. And he wins a chocolate factory, but to win it, he must not see his family anymore. Now, I don't know about you, normal kids would really like a chocolate factory, right? Let's see what Charlie does.
No, I'm not going. I wouldn't give up my family for anything. Not for all the chocolate in the world.
Oh, I see. That's weird. There's other candy too besides chocolate.
I'm sorry, Mr. Walker. I'm staying here.
Wow. Well, that's just unexpected and weird. But I suppose in that case, I'll just... Goodbye, then. Sure you won't change your mind?
I'm sure.
Okay. Bye.
Says it for me, doesn't he? Isn't that cool? That's weird. Well, we're not given a Charlie, we're not given a chocolate factory like Charlie here, but here's what I know. It's normal to reach out and get all the wealth. It's normal to want all the money, but I think it's time that we're weird. Let's be weird Christians, because normal isn't working. Normal isn't building more churches. Normal isn't spreading the gospel of Jesus. Normal isn't working. So let's be weird. Weird with our money. Weird with our time. Seeing a bigger reality, a better priority, and being content with what we have, not always stressing out wanting more. And it's from that attitude that we'll be able to give to God. Because it's not ours. It's his. Please pray with me. God, even in days where we don't always see your blessings, Lord, may you help remind us that we are blessed. And it's from those blessings, Lord, that we're called to give back to you, to give to the church, to give to others, to have that kind of an attitude, Lord, where your blessings come through us. They don't just stop. They go through us and out to others. God, I give you thanks for all those that gathered here today, Lord. For the offering we gave today, Lord, may it be acceptable to you. May it be used by you to do great things in this world. Lord, we're making a difference because normal isn't working. We accept the call to be weird. Lord God, as a church gathered together, we pray together the prayer that your Son Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not in temptation. Deliver. deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.